Now, hi everybody, this is Mary Sutherland, and today I'm going to be speaking on the human psyche, cold-blooded humans versus warm-blooded, lost races, Bigfoot, Dogman, dimensional travel, and also we'll be doing some free tarot readings, and I'll give you some more information too on our party. Party. We love it. We love it. So anyhow, we just got started and people are just now starting to come into the room. Actually, there's nobody here yet. So I got my tarot cards. I'm all ready to go. Using the Psycho Tarot Oracle deck. My favorite so far. I have a different decks for different circumstances though. Like I use the angel messages from the angels for Brad and I reading. So, you know, early in the morning. We do that every day. And then I like the psychic tarot deck for online reading. And let's see. Still don't have anybody in. Hello, anybody there? Okay. Sooner or later they'll pop in, I suppose. I would hope anyhow. Unless we have a problem. It says that there's we got two people here so far. I'll just make sure that the messenger is working here. All right. Yep, okay, messenger's working, and who is in the room? We got, it says two, but it doesn't tell me who. Anywho, yesterday was my birthday. Happy birthday, Mary. But it was also my anniversary, 22 years with the same guy. Pretty good. And I think that he's a keeper, so probably be to another 22 years or more. Anyhow, hoping anyhow. Hi, Carrie. Glad to see that you joined. You're the first one in the room. Da-da-da! So, anyhow, I got my tarot cards, so it's, well, we're waiting until everybody else get in the room. If you want me to give you a little reading, I can do that for you. Oh, thank you. 22 years, Carrie. But I'll say how long I've been married to Brad, but I can tell you how old I am. People have been trying, but it's like, nice try. Nice try. Brad always says he's older than dirt. I'm just not going to go that far. But how old is the soul? You know, we have one body, and physical body's born into this world. Carrie says she just got back from New York. We celebrated 14 years. Oh, so you're a Cancer anniversary as well then? But anyhow, we're born into this world, into a body, so that we can experience. And when the body starts failing us and we can't get around anymore, the soul determines when we leave. But, and so many people are afraid of that, but should we really be afraid of that? Because if we truly, truly believe in what we teach, and then we know that we will be born again. And we also know that where we leave from here is going to be such, if we believe in what Christ said, or Buddha, Krishna, any of those guys, we know that we will be going to a divine place, and we will rejuvenate, and we'll come back. Usually we come back in the same soul group. So, my son. Right now, he's my son, but the next time we come back, maybe what'll happen is he'll be my daughter. Or he'll be my mother or my father. But we seem to exchange roles. And so you kind of got to watch for that with your children too. Like my daughter, she went to a reader one time, came back and told me, she says, "Do you know, Mom, that I went to a reader and that reader told me that in another lifetime I was your mother?" And at that time I wasn't really into spirituality. I was more into the Christian lifestyle. But I always had an open mind. So anyhow, and I got to think about it and I thought, well, that could be true because, I mean, she sure was bossy. And she did not like taking any orders from me. I mean, it was just like, you know. And she felt that that's reason why, is because she still had that leftover residue when she was my mother and she was a strict mother. So it was like how, you know, she still had those feelings. But I figured it, one excuse was as good as another for her being so rebellious, right? Hi, Claire. I'm so glad you're done with your chemo. Brad went through chemo and was so sick from it, but because of it, he lives. So that's a good thing. So, but I'm glad that you're back on your way to being healthy again. Hi, Jazz. How are you doing? Carrie says, yes, we're all soul family. My mom was my wife in a life she said she felt I was her husband. Talk about weird. It is weird, Carrie. It's really weird. But from what I understand, that's how it's supposed to work. And, you know, I know that it has to work because there's been so much documentation of people going under hypnosis and being able to remember their past lives. Then, once they know their name and where they lived, they go and check it out, and sure enough, they find, you know, the grave site, you know, of their, you know, former body. There's been just way too much documented on that for us to disbelieve. And so, we should not fear. Jazz says, regarding the human psyche and beliefs, Mary, how does one tackle the belief of I can't seem to do anything right? That's a good one, Jazz. That's a very good question. And the worst part about it, Jazz, is until you get over that hurdle, you're not going to do anything right. Hi, Veronica. Because our thought, hi, Blake, our thoughts do create. I'm thinking, Jazz, that this is probably due to your religious upbringing, how your parents may have made you feel, how you could have picked it up in school, you know, because I don't know why we've always been taught that we can't do anything right, but it does seem like we've been taught someplace down the road that that's the case. I know that even in the first thing that kids do when they go to Christian schools, you know, Sunday school and stuff like that, for one of the first things they say is, well, you know, you were born into sin. Well, with the imagination of a child, wow, I mean, just kind of let it go at that, huh? And the next thing you know, the mind is creating all these negative things that creates this feeling against yourself that you can't do anything right, that you should be guilty, that you shouldn't have any high expectations. Right, Blake says it takes away your power. It's a fear-based way to keep humans in check. And she's very, very right on that. You know, in spirituality, you know, that's basically what we talk here. I try to encompass it all. And when people ask me what I am as far as Christian or Buddha or whatever, pagan or whatever, I say I am. I am who I am. That's it. I keep my mind open. I try to live the best life possible. I try to make people feel good about themselves. I try to help them evolve to a higher level. I think that you should not throw the baby out with the bathwater. There's something good in Christianity as well as paganism. And we even learn from Satanism, you know. We know what not to do, right? But we learn. Every experience we have, every person we run into, every religion that we come across, it's all there to give us our soul a lesson, all right? So I just say I am who I am. Carrie says, I have a physical proof of one of my lives as a Union soldier. The great great granddaughter of my former self, Union soldier Samuel S. Bell, contacted me at 15 a few years ago. She said she got home, good bumps reading my story and knew I was describing her great grandfather. My chiropractor said he was a Civil War surgeon, which is why he hates blood. I still dislike loud fireworks. Yeah. A lot of times, birthmarks is a great indicator of, like if you'd been into, had been killed in a fight, you may have a wound, the wound that you died from. Could have been an arrow, a spear, whatever, a bullet, but it'll appear as like it will appear as a birthmark. Now, I have psoriasis, for example, and there was a time it was really, really bad, but I finally figured out what to do for it. Vicks Vapor Rub. Once I started using Vicks Vapor Rub, it's just been wonderful. But the psoriasis itself burns and it itches, all right, and it hurts. And I've always kind of wondered about that because a psychic had told me once, she did psychic drawings, and she told me once that I had been a medicine woman, like in pilgrims. Okay, now if I get totally disconnected, I will shut down and I'll start up again as part two. I'll wait a little bit to see if it reconnects. If it reconnects, great. If it doesn't, I'll go with the part two. But as I was saying, psoriasis kind of made me think that why I have it is because it's some sort of a residue left over from when I was burned at a stake. Because it seems like illnesses, certain, I'll let Brad catch that. Illness. At least they know my telephone number, right? So, aches and pains even that you get acquire when you get older, could it be residue from a past life too? Did we all get that telephone number? But okay, so but anyhow, it could be residue left over because we do know that we do have other lives, and usually, when if you're evolving properly, what you will get, like that one that what but usually you what you did in another life, you will carry on in this life and another life ahead of the, next after that one. So like with me, in my past lives, I was a medicine man. I was a shaman. I was a teacher, in Greece. I have that that one where I was burned at the stake, and but see, they're all teaching, and so I'm evolving, but I'm going still going the soul my soul is still going down that same path, trying to learn as much as I can and help as many people as I can. Another interesting thing too is when you're born into this world, you need certain tools in order to be who you're supposed to be, and to have certain characteristics that as tools to help you be the person you are supposed to be. Like I'm a Cancer, all right? So you're born into your sign, which will give you the indication of what your life path is all about. See, like with me, I'm a Cancer. That's Cancers. We're really stuck on truth. We're truth seekers. We're mothers. And not mothers just to our kids. We're just mothers to everybody. We're teachers. So all the characteristics, that's who I am. So I was purposely born into this world on a specific day, a specific month, and a specific time, so that I was already made, my tools were already made available. So you might want to go into your horoscopes if if you're confused on something, go into your horoscopes and find out what your tools are. People say, well, you shouldn't be like that, like me. You shouldn't be so doting on your kids, right? Well, so if I changed that, then I'm actually changing who I actually supposed to be in order to be what I supposed to do. So when people say, well, don't do this, or you're bad, whatever, complain about something you do, look at your horoscope. See what your horoscope says about you. A general, not, a general horoscope will pretty much tell you. And then if you go into precision, like the exact time you were born, then you'll even have more information of what your life path is. So never change yourself because it annoys somebody else. You have to be truthful to yourself. And so going back to you feeling that that you can't achieve anything. Okay, that's because you have to learn how to love yourself. You have to take into account that you were born into this world with a purpose and realize what that purpose is and stick to your guns, be true to yourself, and just remember, you cannot build a house on a flimsy type of foundation. You have got to build that house on a very strong foundation, because if the foundation gives away, the whole house comes tumbling down eventually. So why are you thinking that you can't achieve what you want to achieve? You need to give yourself permission to be able to achieve whatever you're trying to achieve, because the universe does not is it doesn't distinguish between right and wrong, who deserves it and who doesn't deserve it. The universe is just there to provide. So this is something like the elite understand. They understand that they have a right to success, businesses, a lot of money. You know, they're entitled to that. That's how they were brought up. But the other people, other than the elite, we've been brought up by the churches and the schools, and that we're almost kind of like secondhand people, that we don't. That these people that are rich, well, you know, they come from a rich family, so it's, you know, it's understandable they're rich. No, that's not how it works. What we should do and teach our children and ourselves to know that we're just as deserving as anybody else as far as wanting that mansion, that money, whatever, that business, to be successful. And believe in it. Believe in yourself, and you will find that the gates will open, and all those things will start, all these different opportunities will start coming through for you. Now, there's also a possibility, though, that you may not being able to achieve something that you yourself desperately wants. You have to take into the consideration, maybe that isn't part of your path either. Because I know that you have to always take into account your path, your life purpose. But you can be rich with your life purpose as well as the other, you know. So that's a whole different ballgame, what becomes of you with your life purpose, riches, success, whatever. But the universe does have ways of putting obstacles in front of your path to block you from going any further if you're going down the wrong path. It's like a swimmer trying to swim upstream, up against the current, versus a leaf floating down the stream, you know, easily using the current. Then think of the current as the universe. But you just have to realize that, you know, that you are deserving of anything that you choose. Just as deserving as any elitist out there. So thoughts create. And whatever you do, never, 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 never turn around and think of yourself as a second-rate citizen. Never think of yourself as, well, you're not deserving of it. It's always the other person that's going to get the money, not me, because thoughts do create. Change your thinking and change your life. Okay. Right, Lisa. Hi, Lisa. So I see that you gave some people a little bit of HELL the other day on a post, but you're right. Lisa has a lot of people right now trying to step in and tell her what to do. Well, if you know Lisa like we know Lisa, that don't work too well. And she's very strong, and nobody has the right to tell you what to do. You know, I remember going through, before I went through this a divorce one time, people were always saying, well, I wouldn't put up with that. I wouldn't do this. I wouldn't do that. You know, you need to get a separation. You need to get a divorce. Well, and I did. But where were those people afterwards? Were they there to help with the income? Were they there to help with raising my kids? You know, no, they were still friends, but I mean, they were living their own lives. I shouldn't even expected them to help me, but it was my mistake by listening to other people. You know, What would society do if I did this? What would society do if I did that? Who cares what society will think? You're the one that has to go down that path. And it's like being born into this world. You come into this world alone. You go out of this world alone. And basically, you walk this path in life alone. There'll be people there to help you be born, and there'll be people there to help you, you know, pass over. And there'll be people there to help you in this life. But basically, all your choices while you're on this earth plane is going to have to be your choice. And you're going to have to take responsibility for that choice. You know, you can take advice. Advice is wonderful. It kind of helps with the chatter in your head. But when it comes down to that final decision, it's going to be yours. And whatever you decide, it's going to be your decision. So you can't come back and blame anybody else for it, you know. So anyhow, what else do we got? Let's see. Okay, I'm kind of looking through this. Okay, the best I got is, Carrie says, we have been all signs, races, and sexes, at least for myself, it rings true. I agree. And I also believe that we have been on other planets as well. And, you know, somebody told me something the other day, and of course I knew it, but, you know, it won't hurt to have people tell you and kind of remind you. But what is hell? You know, what is karma? You know, it's like if somebody is just bad, like Hitler, Napoleon, or somebody, just bad. They're evil. You know, Mussolini. You know, and they just make everybody else's life miserable. So what happens to them when they die? Well, from how I understand it, they create their heaven or hell here on earth. So whatever they're doing here on this earth plane, they're already creating what they will be living in as soon as they cross over. So if you're a good person and you've helped people out, you know, you're going to have a fairly good life, you know, on the other side. But you may also be born into darkness, into chaos, and into disruption. And this time you won't be the one causing it, but you will be experiencing it. Because that's what the Eshkake Records is all about, too. Is, or the saying, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. It's not so necessary that if somebody puts your eye out that you go and put their eye out, or have somebody else put their eye out. What it is, let's say this person puts your eye out. Well, nothing happens to him until he comes back again. When he comes back again, reborn, he will have to experience the pain that person went through with having that eye taken out. That's the universe balancing it. Once something gets balanced out, then it's smooth sailing again. But the wrong will be corrected. If you're the person that is putting out the wrong, you will be the receiver in the next time around. And so that it has to work that way. It's a yin and a yang. It's the black and the white. It's the right and the wrong. Things have to balance. So that's how it works. Empaths versus psychopaths. Oh my God, John, you just hit me with my whole passion. I'm writing a book right now. God, it's been so long since I worked on it, about a month or so. But it's The Face Behind the Mask. And the book is based on the personalities of the site, of
the empath, the person that wears their heart on their sleeve. It's the person that goes into the room and they feel that the loving energy, or they feel the hatred. When they're around somebody and they're sick, they become sick. So yeah, that's an empath. And you can't lie to an empath. Most empaths, when you're we've gotten to the point where we already, when we walk in the room, we already know what's going on, right? But then everybody, you say, "What's up?" And they say, "Oh, nothing. Everything fine? Oh, yeah, it's just wonderful." And it's like, okay, the empath knows things aren't okay. But we also have to give them that, we have to allow them to come to us if they ever choose to do, to so we can help them. Or people talking behind your back. You know they're talking behind your back, but I mean, there's no proof of it. But I mean, do you really need proof? I mean, people need to learn and trust their gut instincts. If you feel something is not, as like an empath, if you feel that something is not good for you, best thing, don't question it. Just go with your gut instincts. So go with your intuition. Now, when it comes to a psychopath, John, I had this when I had the sci-fi cafe. I used to have these different like ministers, pastors, priests, different like people that come in and talk to me on the side. They wouldn't dare be able to talk to somebody else, their congregation, about some of the things that we used to talk about. We'd sit down and we'd talk religion for hours, and it had nothing to do with what you're learning in church. Trust me on that one. So one day, I think it, I believe it was a Lutheran. Yeah, he was a Lutheran pastor that came in, and I bet you he was there for 4 hours. And before he left, I told him, I said, "You know what? Before you leave, I got one question, and I don't think I want to let it go." And he says, "Well, what is it?" And I says, "Do you think that there are people born without a soul?" And because I always thought maybe they were born without a soul. That's what makes your psychopaths. They don't have a soul. Souls is like your consciousness, right? It's that tells you what's good and what's bad. Should you do this and shouldn't you do that, and why you shouldn't do this, you know? It's your ego. It's your, well, I'm gonna leave it at that. So anyhow, he thought about it and he says, "No," he says, "I actually think everybody's born with a soul. But, big but," he says, "that does not mean that their soul, once their that their soul had been activated." He says, "I think that it kind of stays within the body and it's imprisoned. It just lays there dormant. And the ego takes over and rules that person's life and destroys other people's lives because of it, because of the fact that it doesn't have a consciousness, the soul." And I remember I wrote a book, Living in the Light, Believe in the Magic. And I actually think that in my book, Giants, Gods, and Lost Races, I think I also wrote in there about this. But according to the old books, that there was a time when man, in his evolution, did not. They called it the spark. They did not have that spark in life. They're basically walking around like zombies, really. And the gods ruled them and told them what to do and how to do it. And they just took orders because they didn't have that spark in them to say, "Well, this is right and this is wrong." They just did. Kind of like a zombie, the zombie apocalypse, right? And then at some point of time in human evolution, the angels came to man and presented man with the spark of life that meant consciousness. And so that he would know right from wrong. He would know about, is it right to kill? Is it, should you kill? you know, because you want your neighbor's, I don't know, house or wife or money. Prior to that, they would just somebody say, "Well, go kill this person so I and give me the money." They'd just do it, right? Because they didn't have that good consciousness. And so anyhow, in the old books, it said that the angels gave man the spark. That's what they called it, the spark. And they says some it worked, and there was others it didn't. They remained like animals. And so the ones that received the spark went on, you know, to evolve, where the other ones really didn't so much. And I think that that is your psychopaths. I think that they were born without that spark. That spark was never activated. And the pastor told me, he says, you can tell by looking in their eyes. The eyes, he says, what they say about you can see the person's soul through their eyes. He says it's true. And he says some people have dead eyes. He says for me, I look at it as, you know, their soul hadn't been sparked, activated. And it was funny because see, he was from another state and had looked me up. And it was kind of funny because he said to me, he says, you know, he says, take as an example, he says, your Governor Walker. He says, look in his eyes. He's got dead eyes. And it's like, looky. So, dead eyes. But it's true. I think that they don't have a consciousness. And you know, a long time ago, now remember, if we get cut off, I'm going to wait a while to see if it reconnects. And if it doesn't, then we're just going to, I'll just do up a part two. But when, you know, when I was more involved in UFO research, we had terms for things, right? But they were specifically ufologist terms. You never heard them on the news, because you know UFO researchers are they're woo-woos, right? So we called people the reptilians. Now they don't have a soul, right? Their soul has not been activated. We would call them draconians or reptilians because they were cold-blooded. And in cold blood is your psychopaths. If they were human, they would be your psychopaths and your sociopaths. And about, what was it, about maybe 8 years ago, maybe 10 years ago, all of a sudden, I about flipped one day. I was listening to the news, and somebody referred to a congressman as a draconian. And it's like, well, where the heck did they get that? Because we were the only ones that were using that. And now, then, and time went by. Now they just simply say draconian. It's a draconian idea, or the draconian Congress, or the draconian Superior Court, whatever. And they're also using, reptilian brain. How many people have heard them refer to reptilian brain? And that is the what they're saying, using that in reference to serial killers, that they have a reptilian brain, and saying that a certain part of the brain had never been activated, thus they didn't have that spark of consciousness. And this is, you know, it's tomato, tomato. We've been saying that, well, the ancient texts have been saying this forever. Then the information got lost. Then we started getting the information and putting back out there. The academics and society, they says, oh, well, you guys are woo-woos. It was crazy. And now, draconian is a very, very common word used on the news, you know. And in science, as far as the reptilian brain goes. So basically, I put them into humans into two categories, cold bloods and warm bloods. I totally believe that there are two, when it comes to humans like me and you, I totally believe that there's two races. One race, but broken into two subgroups. And one is the warm bloods and the other is the cold bloods. And the two basically are the prey and the predator. The predator is your cold bloods, the prey is us. And this is where your battle of good and evil comes from. And this is why if you watch, some of these, not all elitists, but a lot of the elitists, especially those in government and and the hierarchy of religious sectors and cults, they believe themselves to be above the rest, and they become the predator. We're the prey. We're the ones that work for them. We're the ones that give them our money. We're to them, we are the second. We're below them. They can feed off of us in one form or another. They can feed off of our energy, or they can feed off of us basically as cannibalism. Jeff Mudgett wrote a wonderful book on H.H. Holmes being, because Jeff Mudgett is the great great grandson of H.H. Holmes, one of the most prolific serial killers in all history, discounting armies, like Napoleon and stuff like that, Genghis Khan that, but I mean just as a an individual, he was born without a conscience. The spark wasn't there. I mean, Naya, I missed because I was doing a tour, so I missed his first show. It's on TV now on the History Channel, and it's a six-part series on H.H. Holmes, and it's based off of Jeff finding the diary, because he had no idea that H.H. Holmes was his great great grandfather until he came across this trunk apparently with H.H. Holmes' diary in it, and showing that that H.H. Holmes was one of the names he used, but his original name was Mudgett. All right, so anyhow, after Jeff got done with the shock factor and the shame, he worked with some of our friends, and one was Jeff Resman that had worked with him and kind of helped him through how he felt, suggested maybe he write a book on it, because a lot of times these books that us authors write is actually like self-help books. We get these feelings out of our out of us, put it down on paper, and then that way we can view the whole thing as a third party. And so anyhow, Jeff did, and he went on to doing this. People got attention, he got the attention required, and now he's got that six-part series out there on H.H. Holmes. I think it's Tuesday night at 9 p.m. Central. And anyhow, I got to watch the episode, and but. Based on just seeing what I had watched on TV, you can tell that he was actually killing people when he was a young child. And 6 years old, he was actually raped by the Catholic priest. 6 years old. Now, most kids would have ran home, told their parents, or felt shame from it. 6 years old, Holmes turned to the priest afterwards and blackmailed him and said, "I will tell and ruin you if you do not do this one thing for me. And that request was that he tell H.H. Holmes, then Mudgett, the confessions from the confessioners, so that he could blackmail the town and make money off the things that he knew that these people were doing. 6 years old. I mean, he was born bad. There are people that are made bad. You know, circumstances in life make them bad. But they're not cold bloods. They can be helped. But a person such as H.H. Holmes, those people, I mean, the soul has never been sparked. There's nothing you can do for people like that. Nothing, you know, except keep them away from society. The movie Jazz, the Transformers talks about the spark known as the All Spark, the Cube. I did not know that. Thank you, Jazz. But that comes from the old books. I'm gonna get. I think I'm gonna get the hiccups. I hope not, but yeah, it's so you get vampire. I did this wonderful show on vampires, and they describe, you know, one of the leaders. It was Ardetha, the self-made vampire, and he was high-ranking vampire. And yes, there really are vampires in the world. And basically, energy vampires. But he said too that there's only two people in the world. There are the predators, and there is the prey. And that a predator, like a fox, would have no sympathy whatsoever for the rabbit that he caught, killed, and ate. And this is your cold blood. These are your sociopaths, your psychopaths. Remember, you don't have to kill, you know, to be a cold blood. Most don't. But they get professions, you know, that that they can excel in because of these feelings, like Wall Street people. There's psychopaths, sociopaths. A lot in attorney. Well, no offense to well, surgeons make good ones too, because of the fact that they can get in there and cut, you know, and they're cold when it comes to emotion. They don't get upset, you know, when they're doing surgery, you know, because something's going wrong. They just take care of the problem. So in some circumstances, you know, such as that, I mean, you know, you don't want an empath going in there and all of a sudden the blood starts coming and you're going, oh my God, I can feel every cut I'm giving out. You know, you want somebody that can separate themselves from it. So anyhow, let's see, Bigfoot and Dogman, dimensional travel I want to talk on, then we want to do some tarot readings. Oh, I wanted to remind everybody that, okay, everybody knows spread my 22nd wedding anniversary. There, would you believe it? People used to warn Brad not to marry me because they didn't feel that the marriage would even last a year. Good thing he didn't listen to them, huh? We sure proved them wrong. 22 years, yay! But, and we're good for each other, you know. I'm kind of flighty and, you know, and jump into trouble, as you guys are all aware of. But Brad he grounds me. And, but he also jumps into trouble right along with me and watches my back. So it works. And so anyhow, so 22 years. And then plus it's my birthday, or was yesterday. But if you're anything like me, you celebrate your birthday for more than one day. So anyhow, we're going to have a huge birthday party at my place, Brad Mai's place in Winslow, Illinois. Probably people will start coming tomorrow because it's going to be Saturday the 15th and everybody's coming. And it's a potluck. There's absolutely no cost to it whatsoever. I kind of like doing it because, when I had the sci-fi cafe, I used to get to meet everybody, but I don't have that chance as much as I used to. So I kind of like to have like one or two of these big parties like this so that I can reacquaint myself with everybody, because it's nice to be able to communicate with everybody virtually. But I'm a hugger, I'm a kisser, I kind of like that stuff. I like seeing my friends. And we're gonna have cakes, we're gonna have a birthday cake, we're having an anniversary cake, we've got all different types of desserts. It's a potluck, so everybody else will be bringing good food. I made up cowboy beans, baked beans, and we've got ham sandwiches, we've got some things for the vegetarians, we've got soda, we got wine, and if you guys want to bring your own wine or a beer or whatever, that's okay too, because this is a party, So they're drinking allowed, just nothing to excess, okay? And then we're going to Steve Spearson's going to be here, and he's going to be doing a talk on UFOs and the Antarctic. And then we've got I may say something, maybe, if I don't get too boring with you guys. And then we have another lady that's coming, and she's going to be talking on the language of light, which I think is going to be totally fascinating. And then I think Alice is going to be here, and she is an astrologist. And she's been doing astrology readings, astrological readings for 40, at least 40 years. She was into doing this stuff before it even got popular. It started out in Chicago, I believe. And anyhow, so, and then we're gonna have card readers here, and then I went and I have a whole bunch of crystal, and what I did today is I did a blessing on the crystal, so that when everybody comes, everybody gets gets a crystal. And that has been blessed by me and the healers and the angels and the guardians. So, and then for people that live too far away or something like that, I'm just gonna let them camp out in the house. And for those that stick around Sunday, and I might even do it Saturday night, I'm not sure. I'm gonna just kind of let it roll. But I thought it'd be fun. Linda Gottfried had been here one time and showed me where that History Channel did that show on these young kids finding, well, young adults finding, going to Avon Bottoms and coming across three dog men getting a drink of water from the river. So, and there's been, and I listened to, and I had listened to Vic Kundo's show, and he had talked about somebody else that had seen Bigfoot and Dogman in that same location. And when we were there, we found Bigfoot prints. So I thought it's not that far away from our house, maybe about 20 minutes. So I thought it'd be kind of fun to take everybody there, ones that want to go, and they can see this area, so next time they watch that documentary, they can say, "Hey, I was there." So anyhow, such is life, huh? So I got time for a few readings if anybody wants to have their cards read. Now, for authors, you are welcome, and tarot readers, you're welcomed. Whoever you're welcome to bring your books, and. Can do a little promo on your books at the party, and if you can sell a few, that'd be great too. Kind of helps pay for your gas. But we have a lot of food. You won't leave here hungry, that's for sure. And so anyhow, that's tomorrow. It's going to start around 11 o'clock. And let's see, Bigfoot, Dogman, dimensional travel. I think that as far as dimensional travel goes, I would highly suggest a lot of you to join my site at my group, facebook.com/groups/Mary Sutherland. And I have written an awful lot on dimensional travel, alternate realities, parallel universes. Stuff is very, very real. And I do have the ability, thank God, that to be able to photograph people going into these other dimensions and photographing entities that have come from the other dimensions into this dimension. I've got pictures of Bigfoot, fairies, and people from this dimension standing on the other dimension. Yeah, it's a dimensional, we're actually dimensional traveling all the time. It's just that we're not aware of it. Anytime that your mind wanders and thinking about something else, you're traveling. Wherever your mind's wandered to, that's where you are. That's why you know, that's where your focus is. So but people don't realize that, but because it's never been told to them. And see, this is something that needs to happen now, is people, they got to be educated as to what is really going on so that they have the choice to be able to understand it. But most of what happens is your soul essence actually leaves your body. Like, let's say, for instance, you're driving. And you just drove down the road 10 miles and all of a sudden it's like, I don't even remember driving down this road. I don't even know where I'm at, right? What's happened? Because they were busy thinking about something. So what happens is the soul leaves, but it leaves just enough of your life force, your intelligence, for the body to be put on autopilot so that you don't hurt yourself or anybody else while you are gone. But you really are gone. And okay, John Cools put in a comment on his Facebook, so you guys are just go to the comments and it'll be right there. Okay. Hi Amy, I don't think I said hi to you. Lori, I don't think I said that. Got a chance to say hi to you either. But yeah, we're always traveling. We etherically go into the other world, and as we go into that other world, we actually materialize again. We solidify. And as we solidify, our DNA absorbs that information into its body while we're there. Then as we come back into this body, we have to do it again etherically, and you know, and then it comes through the veil, comes back into our body, and the body reabsorbs it. And so the information that was given, or that the etheric body received in its DNA, is then transferred into the physical body, and that information starts coming to you through night dreams and daydreams and some of those aha moments. Okay, so we're learning all the time, you know, that not just physically learning, you know, we are absorbing all the time metaphysical lessons. We're traveling all the time. People say to me, well, how can you astral travel? Well, you're astral traveling all the time. You're just not aware of it. If you go into my, you go onto my timeline, go into pictures, under pictures, click on albums. And in those albums, you will see people astral traveling. You will see different entities in other dimensions. Everything I have backup. What I say, I have backup on, physical backup. And that's how I like to roll. I like to get my information from spirit. Okay, and then I like to discuss it back and self with myself, right? And then I like to go out and experience what I just learned. Then I like to research it. I like to come up with my own determination. Most people, what they do is they just go to a researcher on this. Well, I'm not, you know, I mean, it's always good. I like with Gogman, I contact Vic or Kevin or Linda Godfrey. You know, but and say, hey, what do you think? But I don't take any of that as gospel. All that is an opinion. And then I take those opinions into account as I'm solving my problem or my question. But so, and that is what all of you need to do. We should not be worshiping any yogas or teachers, priests, pastors, congressmen, senators, presidents, whoever. You need to learn how to come up with your own determinations based on experience and fact-finding. It's work, but it's fun. And you can trust what you learn, what you have come up with. Everybody else's is just an opinion. Any researcher, it's an opinion. Whether it be on UFOs, dogmen, Bigfoot, cryptology, tarot reading, even. Anything concerning the metaphysics, mediumship, whatever. They are opinions. Sometimes, I mean, you know, like with, there's a few that's really good, with their opinions, or they give great advice. That's what I'm saying. You take that all into account, but you learn from asking questions of everybody else. That's why, like Christians, they only read the Bible. Well, Islam only read their books. You can't do that because that's just one little bit of information among trillions of bits of information. You need to know both sides of the coin. It's like you would never see, that's why we have juries. Is so that you have two cases being presented, all the facts, so that the jury can determine right and wrong. But you just can't have a prosecuting attorney, do their thing, or the defending attorney do their own thing, and expect the jury to be able to give an opinion on it. It just doesn't work that way. You have to have all the information. That's why police go, they don't just go to one person and say, hey, what did you see? They find as many witnesses as possible, and then they try to find that common thread among all of it. And then they go in with their teams, the forensic teams, and all these different people going in, these experts, and checking and measuring, and that's how they make their determination. And that's what you need to do too. I think I'm very, very good at tarot reading, and I know that there's a lot of people at tarot reading, but that's still, even with tarot reading, it's still only one bit of the full picture of the information that you need to know, for making decisions, right? So, and I'm like that. When I first got into the metaphysics, I want to know everything, like right now. Just tell me. I don't want to read it. I don't want to know. I don't want to go all the way, you know, spend weeks and weeks and weeks trying to come up with an answer. Just tell me. But that's not how the metaphysical world works. They'll give you a bit of information until you finally get it. Once you get it, then they'll give you a little bit more, you know. But you'll never get that information until the universe knows that you do get it. And you can't trick the universe because it's all vibratory. It's all energy. When the light shines through, it shines through. You can't just be in the dark and say, hey, I guess what? I get it. You'll say, well, I don't see the light shining through on this. I think we better give you a little bit more time, buddy. And there's a lot of people out there, especially right now, that's taking advantage of the newbies that's coming into the metaphysical world looking for answers. There's cults being born every day. You know, when somebody says, follow me, I'm the one that has the answers, or I'm the living God, you know, or I'm a disciple. You know, spirit only talks to me, so I'll be your intermediary on this. Say no. The spirit talks to everybody. Everybody. And we always talk to spirit. And animals speak to the universe, to God. The birds do. The stones do. The trees do. Every living creature communicates back and forth with God. So anyhow, I'm going to end this tonight. But remember, tomorrow's big day. Okay? And I love you guys. And I'm looking forward to a bunch of you guys appearing. We're going to have some fun. I did this before and you guys all had a great time, remember? So we're doing it again. And love and light to all of you guys. Blessed be. And hopefully I'll see a bunch of you guys tomorrow. The address is 248 Carver Street, Winslow, Illinois. And if you need to get in touch with me, it's 815-367-1006. And you're all welcome. You know, we got a big house, big yard. If it rains, we can always go inside, right? So don't worry about any of that. So probably start about 11 and party till we drop, I guess, huh? And bless all you guys for supporting me all this time. Love you guys. Brad just told me it's time to go because he just fixed dinner. So see you guys tomorrow. Okay. Naturally, there will not be a show tomorrow. But hopefully I'll see a bunch of you tomorrow. Okay. Bye-bye.